sir. All right, guys, so this is week two in our series, Jesus and Stuff. So somebody remind me last week, we're kind of in general what we talked about, and don't just say stuff. I saw my hand go down.
Like only like worship, but we worship other things. Not really worship, but we idolize certain things.
Definitely. So we talked about how Jesus said you can't serve God and money, which translated a different way means you can't really serve both God and your stuff, right?
Yes.
I was waiting for Chris. He's like, wait, what? You're still talking to me?
I smell the chicken boy.
All right, guys, so let's say for the next half hour, y'all don't pay attention to the Chick-fil-A, nothing else, no other trash. Just keep your eyes up here on me, all right? Okay, so what we're going to be talking about tonight is week two, and let's go ahead and get the first slide up there, thank you, Matt. So tonight we're going to be talking about Jesus said, follow me, but leave your stuff behind. So to start off for tonight, you guys remember last week we talked a little bit about what are some of your favorite items, right? And some of y'all, like the one that stuck out my mind, Cole, you said, you were like, man, I love my socks. Hey, you got them on? Yeah. Awesome.
Did you wash them?
No, it's a daily plan.
Oh, okay.
I mean, they are all in color, though, right? Hey, that's all right. I forgive you. They're still awesome socks. So... But guys, the thing we talked about was, you know, hey, favorite items, and how does that kind of tie in? Well, I only heard from maybe, I don't know, maybe a fourth of y'all in here. So tonight, I just want to start out by kind of revisiting that question. Now, what would you guys say, somebody who didn't answer last week, like, what is one of your very favorite items in the whole world? Michaela?
Tumors lemonade.
Tumors lemonade? Michaela, we're going to have a talk after this about changing your mind, going back to Alabama.
Because once you visit Alabama, you'll have the same exact dog.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Exactly. Thank you. Curtis.
I have three things.
Three things.
Food.
Yeah. Food.
Yeah. And food.
Wait, didn't you answer last week? Because I remember you giving me that answer.
Well, I said bed last week.
Oh, you said bed last week. All right. Awesome. So somebody else who did not answer last week, tell me one of your favorite things. Fried chicken. What about, like, think of maybe more like a permanent possession, not just food, but like an item that you own?
Material items.
Material items, exactly. So, Kelsey, are you volunteering to?
I already said Netflix.
That's
yay!
Right. I mean, that is a thing, but you have, like, say, maybe another thing.
Yeah,
like,
my phone.
Your phone? Okay. All right, what else we got? Rachel. Your books?
Okay. Yeah.
Very good. Any particular favorite one? Do you have like a very favorite book? Greek mythology?
Really?
Good for you. Anybody else? Somebody who's not answered yet? Alright, let me pick on a couple of y'all. Noah, what is your favorite item? Or do you have something like, you know, what if it's something you thought, like, man, I just cannot live without this item? Bank of America, y'all know Bank of America, one of the biggest banks in this country, they did a study like 4 or 5 years ago, where they polled people for this very question, and they said, what are some things you just absolutely cannot live with in life? And the answer that 45% of the people polled gave was, they said, I can't go a single day without my cell phone. Like, not one. I'm not able to go one day without it. And get this, people in y'all's age group, teenagers, they answered and they said, I would rather go without the internet, I would rather go without my toothbrush, and I would rather go without deodorant for an entire day. Instead of going without your cell phone. And see, when I read that, I was just like, wow, that really stinks. Literally. I mean, who would do that?
But that is how
addicted we've gotten to our cell phones. And the guys, look at the picture up here.
Does that remind you of the one on the right? Does that kind of remind you of anybody?
Because when I saw that, I was like, wow, that's me half the time. Do any of you guys ever look like that? Or maybe you're holding a conversation with somebody, maybe you're texting or talking or doing something at the same time. Yeah, it is true. But we've gotten to that point. Hey, guys. Guys, pull it back in, okay? Guys, listen to me. Thank you, guys. So, but that is the thing. We've all gotten to that point, and maybe, you know, some of us more so than others, but we've gotten so addicted to our cell phones and our technology that we rather would give up, you know, almost anything. That it's like, no, I can't go a day without it because what if somebody sends me a text? Or what if I get a Facebook notification and I can't check? So, we're going to see a little bit about, we're going to look at a Bible passage tonight where somebody was in that same situation where they were like, wow, I really love Jesus. I really want to follow after him, but I'm just cleaning my stuff so much. Okay, so if y'all would, if you have your Bibles, turn with me, or if you don't have them, it'll be on the screen. Turn to Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. Give y'all a few seconds to get there. And again, it will be up on the screen, or you can just listen along when I read. Alright, so starting with verse 17 in Mark chapter 10, it says, as Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down, and asked, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, why do you call me good? Only God is truly good. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. You must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and mother. Teacher, the man replied, I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young. And looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. He said, there is still one thing you haven't done. Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. And it says that this, the man's face fell, which means, you know, he basically got like this. And he went away, for he had many possessions. Okay, so I got an initial question for y'all about this passage. And this is kind of, this doesn't directly tie in with the lesson, but I think it's something that's interesting. Have you guys ever read this passage before, and then you see where Jesus says, he asked the man, he says, why do you call me good? Because none is good but God. Has that ever confused any of y'all a little bit? Because I know the first time I ever read this passage, I was like, well, Jesus was God, so why is he telling the man not to call him good? And this is something that some, I guess you could say, liberal scholars actually try to claim. They say, oh, well, Jesus wasn't really the Son of God because he said, why do you call him good? But that isn't what Jesus is saying at all. He was testing the young man to see where his heart really was, because the young man ran up to him and he said, good teacher. And Jesus was kind of, you know, picturing having kind of a skeptical face. He says, well, only God's good, so why do you call me that? He was trying to test him to see if the man actually believed that Jesus was the Son of God. So anyway, I just wanted to throw that out there. If that ever confused any of y'all, that's all Jesus is saying. He's not saying, hey, I'm not God. He was simply just trying to see where the man's heart was. So let me ask you this. In verse 17, what do you think the rich young man's intentions were? Did he really want to know how to get to heaven? What do you guys think? Andrew?
I think he probably just tried to get something.
A blessing? Okay. Interesting. And I guess let me ask you, what makes you think that, I guess that he wasn't being Jesus.
Because most people that are genuine in their approach will like to be in space.
Absolutely. So maybe there was a little bit of a, you know, his heart wasn't completely sincere, I guess. But what do you guys think? Could y'all agree with what Andrew just said? Or did any of y'all feel like that? He was probably real and wanted to go to heaven.
I'm sure he wanted to go to
heaven. Okay, you touched on something important there, because he wanted to go to heaven, but maybe he didn't want to do everything that it took to truly go there. And see, I think you're right. I don't think there's any reason to doubt that he was sincere, that he truly did want to inherit eternal life. But as we see later, yeah, he didn't really want to do whatever it took. Do you think, and this question's for everybody, do you think the young man approached salvation as works-based? And in case some of y'all haven't heard that term before, works-based just means that I have to do something to earn my way to heaven. Brandon, you say yes. Why? Boom. Okay, see, that's it exactly. If y'all heard what Brandon just said, that he said, what must I do? He was approaching this because we have to keep in mind that this man was a Jewish man. In Jewish culture, that's what they were accustomed to, is, hey, you have to keep the laws of Jesus in order, essentially, in order to gain salvation. And that's not really the way it worked. But a lot of times, that's how the Jewish people approached it. Because remember, Jesus hadn't died and hadn't risen again yet, so that's really all they knew. Right? At this point, is they knew that, hey, we gotta follow God's laws, we gotta follow God's Ten Commandments in order to try to get to heaven. Now, why do you guys think that Jesus chose to ask him if he had kept the commandments? Wouldn't this kind of imply that Jesus was played into the works-based salvation? What do you guys think? Yes or no? Jonathan, I see you shaking your head back there. So why would you say, why no?
Well, what we were going through on Sunday nights is like we ask these questions like when you really like a good person and you try to have your own. And he's just trying to kind of prove just like you want. No matter what you try to do, you're not going to do
something. And that's it, absolutely. Because Jesus was trying to explain to the young man that he was trying to show him, hey, you know, you are obeying, you know, at least some of the rules, but your heart's still not in the right place. And that's what he was trying to get this guy to see. Now, I got this. This is a super tough bonus question for all of y'all. And let's see if y'all, like, really, really know your Bibles. And it's okay, I'm not going to judge anybody because I actually didn't know this one ahead of time either. But you'll notice that Jesus, and Matt, can we put verse 19 back up there for a second? Thank you. So you'll notice that Jesus names a few of the Ten Commandments off, but not all ten of them. Why did Jesus choose to name the commandments that he did? And again, this is super tough. I see Andrew's got his hand up. I'm sorry, I missed what you said there at the end. On a certain
day.
On a certain day? Kind of. You're kind of getting there. Let's see, let's go with Cole. Sorry. In Jesus' name, okay. Y'all are kind of, you're starting to touch on it a little bit, Curtis.
He thought he decided to name one that he thinks he had fallen. That way he would say, well, I have honored you, Lord, and then that way he can deal with, okay, you went out of the
bedroom. Okay. And Jessica, I saw your hand up. He said, oh, okay. I got you, Brandon.
He didn't really mean to say that. You probably would have been useful. You wouldn't have to say all the things. You
So, maybe he just needed to name a few. Okay, I love the answers y'all gave, because they're all good, and they're all getting, you know, fairly close to the answer. But here's why Jesus listed the ones that he did. He listed the last six of the Ten Commandments, and all of the last six of the Ten Commandments all deal with how we relate to other people. It's what, you know, how we relate, you know, to our fellow man, if you will. So he going through those commandments, and he's like, hey, have you kept all of these? And the guy's like, yeah, you know, teacher, I've kept all of these since I was young. I've done all of these. But the reason Jesus didn't sell him the first four, rather, is because all four of the first ones all relate to how man deals with God, how our hearts are towards God. And he didn't point those out because the man's heart was obviously not in the right place. Yeah, maybe he had followed all the rules about treating other people well, but where was his heart truly when it came to following after God? So, my next question for y'all is, and we kind of touched on this last week, but I want to go just a little bit more in depth on it tonight. Is Jesus saying that there's something wrong with being rich or having stuff? Or is Jesus saying that the young man would be saved simply because he sold all his stuff off? What do you guys think? Jonathan?
So he's basically saying that this stuff shouldn't matter, shouldn't be more important.
Absolutely. So it's not really so much the fact that he was selling his stuff off. He was saying, hey, your priorities are in the wrong place. Okay. Curtis, what have you got?
You want to see if, like, wasn't too attached to his stuff. So he gave it away, and he gave it away for that he wasn't attached to him.
Okay. I like what you guys said. What do the rest of y'all think? Do you think Jonathan and Curtis, are they right or are they wrong? Man, y'all are quiet tonight. Brandon?
It's not really about what you have to do. If you go through life, and you start to move back to the system, you start to move on. Those things were gained through humbling God today, not simply being people. It's how you got it and how you use it.
Absolutely. So, you know, the stuff is a blessing from God, but it's not. If we make it more about the stuff and less about God, then our hearts are all out of whack and our priorities are in the wrong place, right? Gotcha. Very good answer. I like that. So, yeah, I mean, it's not just stuff, though. I guess, and this is one of the real key points I want to touch on tonight, is really what Jesus was getting at with the rich young ruler. He's saying, hey, your stuff's standing in your way of following me. But think about life. How many things do we let stand in our way of our relationship with God? It's not just always material stuff, is it? Sometimes, you know, we prioritize our relationships with others before God. You know, maybe it's like if you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a really good best friend or, you know, any other kind of relationship, you know, sometimes that becomes so much, you know, of what your life revolves around that it can be real easy to be like, okay, you know, God's supposed to be up here. Here's my relationship. And it kind of tips the other way, doesn't it? Because, like, how many times have you guys seen, let's say, like, a Facebook post where, you know, either a guy will be talking about his girlfriend or a girl will be talking about her boyfriend, what have you, and the person says on there, oh, I love this person, they are my world. How many of y'all, show of hands, have ever seen a post like that? Because I would say I see at least probably one or two a week on my Facebook feed. Okay, so guys, did you hear what Kelsey said? That's a really good point that it's about a different, sometimes it can be about a different person. You know, it's like somebody's their world and then somebody else is their world. See, that's the thing. There's absolutely nothing wrong with really loving and caring about somebody else deeply. But if we put that person before God, then everything starts getting out of whack, right? Because in any relationship, Christ should be at the center of it. It's like Scripture says. It says a cord of three strands is not easily broken. So you picture, you know, like a big thick rope. You know, and God's that strand in the middle. And if you revolve or twist yourself around God, it's not going to break. But you put the person first, the Christ isn't in the middle, the rope's going to snap, right? So, kind of think of it that way. So, this is what I want you guys to think about tonight. Where are your hearts currently? And this isn't like me sitting up here like pointing the finger at anybody because, you know, I could be pointing back at myself. But where are our hearts? Would you guys say, You know, we named some of our favorite items and things earlier. Would you be willing to give up anything in order to put God first, in order to follow Jesus? Could you say honestly, deep down in your heart, you would be willing to give up anything you had in this life to follow Him? And I'm not going to ask you all for like a show of hands, like, okay, you know, whose heart's there and who's not, because, like, I can say when I was y'all's age, I don't know if I could honestly answer yes for that question. You know, I was certainly a believer, I followed Jesus, but I don't know if I could have said honestly that I would be willing to give up anything, because, you know, when I was, say, 16, 17 years old, you know, my heart was very much on the things of this world. And I can say that thankfully, by His grace, that finally I'm to the point in my life where now I can say yes, honestly, I'm willing to give up anything in order to follow Him. My stuff, it just doesn't matter to me anymore. Like, for example, what's running the slideshow tonight, I got my MacBook back there. Yeah, I love my MacBook. That's like probably one of my favorite things I own. I love that computer. It's awesome because it does so many useful things for me.
I got the wooden bat again, if you'd like.
What's that now?
I got the wooden bat, if you want to.
Oh man, did you want to do a repeat of last week?
But with your MacBook.
You would seriously see a grown man cry. It's like, man, I don't have this thing paid off yet. But that computer's great. But suppose Jesus was to walk up to me today and say, you know, come sell your MacBook and follow me, which is essentially what he was telling me. This guy, I can tell you honestly, I'd be willing to do it. I'd be like, okay, Lord, you know, take me where you want me to go. I don't care about the MacBook. But again, 10 years ago, I don't know if I would have had that response. I would have been like, oh, you know, man, you know, okay, Lord, but really, I like this thing. So this is what I want you guys to think about. And you'll be talking about this somewhat in your small groups once we split off here in a couple of minutes. It's where are your hearts? So we can sum up, I guess, what we talked about tonight is really this question. And if you don't hear anything else I said tonight, please really, really think about this following question. It'll be up here on the screen. Are you willing to give up anything, anything in your life, you know, possessions, relationships, whatever, are you willing to give up anything for the one who gave you everything? And this ties back into what Brandon said, is He's the one who gives us everything in life. We can't have any good gifts without Him. But is your focus more on the blessings instead of the one who blessed you with those things? So guys, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for us here. And then we're going to split up into small groups. Matt, how do you want to split them up tonight?
Three groups. We got three rooms on this wall. And we've got three leaders.
All right. Awesome. So guys, let me pray for us. And then you just pick one of the rooms you want to go into. And that'll be your small group for the night.
Well, we need nine in two of the rooms and 10 in one of the rooms.
And 10 in one of the rooms?
I'll be counting.
Okay, gotcha. So guys, let's bow our heads and pray, all right? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to be here in this place together tonight. Lord, I just pray that each of our hearts were convicted, because I know mine certainly was through this message. Lord, help us to reprioritize our lives if we need to. Lord, help us never to make the stuff that you give us be more important than you. And Lord, help us to give up whatever it takes in order to follow you. Because Lord, we don't want to be like the rich young man, Father, who said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? But then when you told him, sell your things and come follow me, then he went back to his stuff. Lord, help us never to be like that. Help us to be willing to draw whatever it is in our lives to pursue you, because you are the most important thing in our lives. So, Lord, as we go into our small groups tonight, please just bless our time. Lord, purify our hearts. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.